We have a great question about hands that get tired in downward facing dog. And this question was submitted by Karen, and I'm going to read it and then we'll talk about it. So Karen says, for the down dog regression of putting blocks underneath the hands, I really like this one, and I've used it on myself and told students to do that too. However, I noticed that my wrist slash hands would sometimes feel tired or more tired after doing this modification. Do you think this is normal and why might that happen? Are there any methods to reduce the load on the wrists in down dog? I have told students to spread their fingers out wide and press into their knuckles, but a student tells me that her hands still get tired easily. So that is our question. Tired hands in downward facing dog. So I'm gonna address tired hands in down dog in general, like as a general phenomenon. But first, let's look at Karen's specific question about the specific regression that I talked about in the down dog video, which is hands on blocks in downward facing dog. Because Karen said when she does that, she finds that her hands get more tired than they do when her hands are just on the floor. So, like, what's up with that? So, overall, when we're looking at the whole body and the way that the loads are distributed in the body in down dog, when the hands are higher, like the higher the hands are relative to the rest of the body, the less overall load in the upper body. So, the higher the hands are, the more we shift load into the lower body and the more we are offloading the upper body. So, hands on blocks is less load on the upper body than hands on the floor. Hands on a chair seat in down dog would be even less. Hands on the wall would be even less. I mean, this would be virtually no load on the upper body here. So, the progressively lower your hands go, the more we're adding load to the upper body. But with all of that said, Karen still feels tired in her hands when she does hands up on the blocks, like more tired than hands on the floor. So, what's going on there? Now, I certainly can't be sure, but one thing that I think is a possibility is that when our hands are on blocks, there is not as much friction between our hand and the surface of the block as there is between our hands and the yoga mat, which should be sticky. Yoga mats are sticky. So when we have the hands on the blocks and then we press back into down dog, there's like a force that kind of wants to move our hands that way. And we might feel like it's slippery. And whether we consciously realize this or whether it's unconscious, there can be a tendency when the hands are on the blocks to want to grip around the blocks with our fingers to grip so that we feel stable and like we'll stay in place. And if that's happening, if we're gripping a lot on the blocks in order just to hold position, then I could certainly see how hands on blocks would make the hands more tired than hands on the yoga mat because we're working these muscles of the hands more, or the muscles of the forearms really, more in order that's creating force that's trying to keep our hands in place. So, I have a tip that I really like for hands on blocks, which really will help with that issue. And that is just that instead of placing your hands just right smack in the center of your blocks, instead of that, bring the hands down lower, so more toward you and toward this bottom edge of the blocks. And then once you have your hands there, just a little bit of flesh of your wrist can kind of scoop around the bottom edge of your block. And it can serve to kind of hook around there and hold you in place. It's like you have a little stopper there. So instead of hands on the middle of the block where they can just, feel like they'll slide forward, hands closer to you, and then just the very base of your wrist, just like the flesh that's there, kind of wraps down a little bit. And if you do that, you should find, it's just subtle. It's like instead of hand here, it's back here. But if you do that, you should find that with your wrists hooked like that, you feel more just like parked in place and like your hands are not gonna go anywhere. So that alone, just that little subtle shift can help the pose so that you don't feel like you have to actively grip and then you're not working the muscles of finger flexion, and then you're not getting so tired in your hands. So just a little repositioning so that you kind of lock yourself in place would be helpful, could be helpful. So that's just to address the hands on the blocks regression and kind of reducing the need to actively grip so much. But let's talk now about just like tired hands from downward facing dog in general. So I know that that's hand and wrist fatigue from really yoga in general, not just down dog, but all of the weight bearing that we do on our hands in yoga, like plank, up dog, chaturanga to down dog, just side plank, all this stuff. We do a lot of weight bearing. And so it makes sense that our hands could feel fatigued and the wrists could feel fatigued. So one point about that is that simply just loading the hands and continuing to practice yoga should in and of itself help strengthen up the muscles of the forearms that control and work the wrists in these positions, will help them to become stronger. And that should help. It's just like conditioning over time. The body, our body is adaptable. We adapt to the loads that we experience. And so with more time on the mat and more time in yoga, we should naturally adapt and become stronger in the hands. So with time, most people should find that the hands become less fatigued. However, another thing to consider with like hands that might feel tired is our yoga mat. Either is our mat slippery or are we sweating in our hands? And then is that causing some slippage? Because especially in down dog, because of this oblique angle of the pose, like we kind of already saw with the hands on the blocks, if it's not super sticky for you here, if you're sweating in your palms, and maybe if your mat is not the most sticky, then there won't be as much friction. And then again, it's the same thing with the blocks. It's like you feel like your hands want to slide forward. So to counter that, you may be here and you may be gripping just to hold on, like gripping like this. And if that's the case, once again, just like with the blocks, that would tend to tire the hands more. So that's why like having a really sticky mat can be helpful, because you don't have to work as hard because you're just parked in place because of the friction. So if that's an issue for a yoga practitioner, maybe consider either getting a stickier yoga mat or one of those towels that you can lay on top of your mat that's like a grippy towel that once you start sweating, it totally grips and interacts with your hand to keep you in place. So just something to make there to give more friction between your hand and the surface of the mat. That would be helpful. So that's one tip. And then, like I said earlier, the other tip of just in general, we get stronger in our muscles when we use them. When they're exposed to load, then we have to adapt. So often with time, feeling of hand tiredness, if it's not about the slippery thing, but if it's just about the loads of yoga are making me tired, then we should adapt to them over time. But aside from all of that, there are certainly some proactive strategies that we could take on. And this is just helpful in thinking about like the body and movement and adaptation in general. If hands and wrists are getting tired in these arm weight bearing poses in yoga, something we could do is just some direct hand and wrist strengthening that we could do within a yoga practice or outside of a yoga practice. And I'll just give a couple examples, but to do some dedicated strengthening for this area, if this area is proving to be a weak link for someone in their practice, if that's where they're getting tired, if that's what's limiting them in their practice, then some dedicated strength training for this area could be helpful. So like an example, just to get us thinking about this, one example is to, actually use weights. And for example, you can hold weights in your hands and just holding them, just even standing and holding the weights will start to add load to the muscles, your grip muscles, and it will strengthen the muscles of wrist flexion. So you could stand, you could walk. This would be called like a loaded carry in the strength training world. There are all sorts of variations of a carry. You could do one-sided where you just hold one weight instead of both. But there are all these variations, and of course, different amount of weight varies. These are 25-pound dumbbells, but you could use any weight that works for your body. And so anyway, so loaded carries and just holding on to weights, things that are heavy that want to pull your fingers like this, but you have to grip in order to hold, that's great for loading and strengthening the hands. And then in addition, basically just all strength training exercises just about that in which we do like pulling, like upper body pulling. So for example, Something like this would be a single arm row here where I'm pulling the weight up. So this is, of course, strengthening for my biceps and shoulder pulling muscles in general, like the lats. But as a side benefit, because I'm holding a weight that wants to pull down like this, just being here and doing this, the amount of time that I'm doing this, in addition to the shoulder work, I'm also working my grippers. So all sorts of pulling exercises, including hanging from a bar, if you just did hanging, or if you work on like pull-up progress, you know, trying to get toward a pull-up, anything like that, gravity wants to pull you down and you know, release the grip, but you have to grip to hold to keep yourself up there. So all sorts of upper body pulling exercises that are classic strength training, are really good for improving grip and hand and wrist strength. But that's strength training, and that's like typically using, you know, strength equipment. That's not necessarily, like, if we're just talking within a yoga setting and not using weights and things like that, but just yoga, there is another exercise that I really like, and this one's great. It can be done on the mat. You could do it with your students, right within the context of a yoga practice. It fits in perfectly. So this is how it goes. This is called wrist flexion push-up. And you go like this. You're on hands and knees, your hands are flat, and then we simply lift our wrists up off the floor and we lower back down with control. You lift up and you lower down. And what this is doing is it's working the muscles on the underside of the forearm that perform wrist flexion, and it will help to strengthen the wrists. And the way that we kind of modulate the work here is that the further forward that your shoulders are, the harder this will be. So if you're straight, shoulders right over wrists, you might find, oh, this is hard. This is like more load and really hard. So the further back you are, the less work it is. So you just kind of decide like where the rest of your body goes, the load goes. So shoulders more forward, more load in the arms and bearing down on the wrists. More load you have to work against. It's harder. But if you shift back, kind of like in down dog, we're talking about like with the hands higher, that's a form of kind of shifting back. We send more weight into the lower body. Same thing here, shift back. There's less load on the arms. And when you're really wanting to strengthen, it's helpful to, you know, work repeated lifts. So you actually would do this several times in a row until you get to the place where you can hardly do it again. That's called momentary muscular failure. And if we did that, that's usually enough to stimulate some strengthening adaptations. And then we would want to do the exercise also on a regular basis, you know, for optimal actual strength adaptations. So anyway, yeah, everyone's different and there's a lot of flexibility here, but for an effective like wrist flexion push-up, maybe you would, and you might guide your students to find the place, like position their body in the place where they can do maybe like 10 to 12 of these, 10 to 12, and then they kind of can't do anymore, or they're really close to not being able to do anymore. So they need to find that place, find that amount of load where they can do 10 to 12 reps, you might call it. And that would be a good place for them to work. And then maybe they'd want to do like two, maybe three sets of those, like in one yoga practice, and then try to do it once to twice a week, kind of regularly. And that would be a really nice way to condition and build strength around the hand and the wrists in a very specific position, very yoga specific. Like this, you know, is a position we load so much in yoga. So if we do some dedicated strengthening, that can be really helpful for reducing that issue of like the hand and the wrist fatigue. So I hope that this was helpful. I hope this answered Karen's question. Let me know if you have any follow-up questions, and yay for stronger hands and fingers and wrists overall.